Do you have trouble putting your words into feelings or even knowing how you feel about something? What you're experiencing may be alexithymia. I'll explain. I'm Dr. Tracey Marks, a psychiatrist, and I make mental health education videos. Alexithymia is a term used to describe the problem of not being able to identify your feelings, trouble describing how you feel to others, and difficulty interpreting others' emotions from facial expressions or body language. You may also be unable to distinguish between physical and emotional aspects of an experience. This description may make you think, well, that sounds like autism spectrum. What's the difference? Well, alexithymia can be one aspect of autism spectrum disorder, but autism spectrum disorder involves much more than this one characteristic. I talk about the different features of autism spectrum disorder in this video. Alexithymia is not a disorder in and of itself. It's a set of symptoms or difficulties that a person can have that can be found within lots of disorders. It can happen in some neurological disorders like frontotemporal dementia or in someone who's had a stroke. It can also be part of a depression or schizophrenia. We don't know exactly what causes alexithymia, but some people can have it as a standalone problem and not have another disorder. But it can end up causing a lot of social problems and attachment difficulties. As you can imagine, it may be hard to feel connected to someone if you struggle to appreciate how you feel when you're around them. And the person on the receiving end of a conversation with someone with alexithymia can feel like the person may be holding back and not being forthcoming with things, like they're hiding something, when really the problem is they just don't know what to say. For example, let's say you and I are having lunch and I tell you that I lost my job. I'm looking for support, like for you to say something like, oh, I'm sorry. But instead, you say, oh, are you going to get another one? It doesn't occur to you that maybe I'm telling you this because I want you to feel bad for me. In your mind, it's just another fact that I'm mentioning, and now you follow up with another fact-related question. So I think, boy, that's really insensitive, and I don't feel good when I'm talking to you, so I guess I won't be sharing sensitive topics with you anymore. Now, this is just an example. Not everyone with alexithymia thinks the same way or processes information the same way. There are degrees of it. On one end of the scale, you may lack all awareness of your emotions as well as the emotions of others. And on the other end of the scale, you may have some insight, but you still struggle with the specifics. Using the lunch example again, on one end of the scale, you may recognize that I feel bad, or this experience that I had was bad, there was something bad about it, but your thinking doesn't go much further than that. Bad is pretty generic. So another way this conversation could play out is, I tell you I lose my job. You recognize that that's a bad thing and say, oh, I'm sorry. I hope you find another one. So you're going to get the steak or the fish. Now, this sounds like something you could hear on a comedy show, but it's far from comedy. The person on the receiving end can feel offended and even angry at their so-called friend, and the person with alexithymia can feel misunderstood and frustrated with their inability to have these emotional conversations. It can feel like an unreasonable demand to be expected to go deep with everything. Talking about emotions is not that deep when your emotions are on the surface and easy to express, but when they're not, it feels like people are trying to extract something from you that you just don't have. Sometimes people with social anxiety can have trouble expressing themselves around others, but not because you don't know what you feel, but because you're caught up in your head, heavily scrutinizing what you want to say to make sure that you're not going to say something that makes you look stupid. But if you're in a group or in the middle of a conversation in a group, by the time you get the wording just right, the opportunity to say it has passed, and now you're on to thinking about something else. Outwardly, it can look like you have nothing to say, but you do. It's just that your anxiety keeps you from saying it. Another sign of alexithymia is having trouble interpreting metaphors. We speak in a lot of metaphors in abstract language. Here are some common ones. You need to see the light at the end of the tunnel. Don't let yourself get behind the eight ball. You're a loose cannon. You drive me up a wall. These are very cliched phrases that are so commonly used that it's easy to forget that not everyone knows what they mean. If you have alexithymia and struggle to understand figurative speech like this, you may feel too inhibited to stop someone and ask them to explain what they're talking about, especially if you're in a group. So you can miss half the conversation and not know what people are talking about and feel incredibly isolated and even alone, even though you're with a group of people. One of the big challenges with this is it can go unrecognized, even to you. You can experience it as not clicking with people. You can tell yourself that you're just not a people person because it's unpleasant being around them, but you don't really know why. You conclude that people just aren't your thing. Some people can feel hostile toward the person with alexithymia because it feels like you're hiding something or intentionally holding back. They can't figure you out, so they feel threatened. As a result, you could have experienced bullying as a child or even aggression from a frustrated parent who doesn't understand why you can't just speak up or be honest. Alexithymia typically affects around 10% of the population, though some studies suggest it could affect up to 25%. What can you do to improve your emotional awareness? One way is to use mindfulness meditation to focus on your thoughts and feelings without judgment. And there are different ways to use mindfulness to recognize your emotions. But one way is to do a body scan and notice what you're feeling in your body. Then attach an emotion to the feeling. Let's say you feel a pit in your stomach. What does that pit feel like? Fear? Anger, sadness, love, shame, then mentally label it in your mind as if you're saying it to yourself. If you notice another body sensation, label that one based on how it makes you feel as well. If there seems to be a disconnect between your label and what you feel, as if your label's wrong, try using a different label. This simple exercise helps you develop the habit of recognizing your emotions. Another technique people will use is affective labeling. This is where you assign emotions to experiences. You think about a situation that created a strong emotion for you. It could be a conflict that you had with someone or even something that happened to you that made you feel really good. Write down how it made you feel. What did the person say that made you feel that way? Was there a subtext message like, they didn't really say that, but they implied something. What was that hidden message that you heard, and how did that make you feel? For affective labeling, you just want to identify the triggers for the emotions and how they made you feel and attach the word to that feeling. If you have the means to see a professional, art therapy has been found to help people connect with their emotions. And then there's reading fiction stories. Good descriptive stories can increase your vocabulary for emotional words and illustrate what other people think and feel in situations. I have some exercises that may help you with increasing your emotional awareness. I'll tell you more about it in my next video next week. Once that video publishes, it'll be linked right here. Thanks for watching. See you next time.